إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله تعالى وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. The words collected in the Sahihain of Al-Bukhari and Muslim on the authority of the illustrious companion Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to a man from the delegation of Abdul Qais, and these people, this community, this delegation of the tribe of Abdul Qais, they came from the area of Bahrain, the eastern area of what was Arabia back then. They, as we know, were well-known established communities of Muslims in the cities of Mecca and Medina. But there were also pockets of Muslim communities in other parts of Arabia. And from them was this tribe, the people from this tribe of Abdul Qais. The first Jumu'ah to be established in Islam was in the city of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina. But the second Jumu'ah to be established outside of the city of Medina was with this tribe, these people of Abdul Qais, in a place called Juwata in Bahrain. The distance between them and Medina was far. And because of the enmity towards Muslims and also because of the rivalries and the tribal war that existed between the different clans and tribes of the Arabs, those people found it extremely difficult to come to Medina to meet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But around the 3rd or 4th year of the Hijrah, a group of them came, it is said 12, 13 in number. They came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet said to one of them, a man by the name of Al-Ashaj, he said to him, إِنَّ فِيكَ خَصْلَتَيْنْ يُحِبُّهُمَ اللَّهِ الْحِلْمُ وَالْأَنَاءِ. You have two attributes that are beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first is patience and forbearance, the second is that you are calm, calmness. It is said, as Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala mentions in his explanation of this hadith, he said that there is a narration that these people, when they came from a very far distance, took them days and days to get to Medina.
And when they arrived, they came straight to the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They saw and recognized the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So as they came off of their animals, despite all of those days of travel, the dust, the sweat, the toil, the hardship of travel, they came and they rushed to meet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. All of them, except for that man Al-Ashaj. He got off his horse, and it is said that he washed himself, and he put on a clean pair of clothes, and then and only then did he come and give salams to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saw the way that he behaved as opposed to the rest of them, he said this to him, إِنَّكْ فِيكَ خَصْلَتَيْنْ يُحِبُّهُمَ اللَّهَ الْحِلْمُ وَالْأَنَاءَ. You have two things that Allah Azza wa Jalla loves. Number one is that you're a person that is patient. Number two, that you have calmness. Didn't rush like the rest of them. Wasn't hasty like the remainder of them. He was calm and collected. He thought it through. Those are things that are beloved to Allah Azza wa Jalla. And that is a principle, therefore, that you find in the Quran and in the Sunnah. Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions it in different ways. Sometimes speaking about the virtues of being calm and patient. And sometimes about dispraising, speaking about the ills of being hasty and rushing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Isra, وَيَدْعُ الْإِنسَانُ بِالشَّرِّ دُعَاءَهُ بِالْخَيْرِ وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ عَجُولًا. A person will make dua for evil just as they make dua for good, because mankind is ever hasty. Scholars of Tafsir said that this verse refers to those people who, because of a moment of anger or a moment of high emotion, they end up making dua against themselves, against their own family and children, against their own wealth, against the blessings that Allah bestowed upon them. Just as one of you makes dua for good, some of you will make dua for evil against themselves, just because in that moment they're so overcome by passion, by emotion. Why? وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ عَجُولًا. Mankind is hasty. They don't stop, they don't think, they don't take a moment to seek advice and to look at perhaps the repercussions of their decisions. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, speaking about the nature of humankind, you and I, خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ مِنْ عَجَلٍ. Mankind was created from haste. It's our nature to be hasty. And so when we hear something, we respond in a hasty fashion. When someone does something to us, we lash out and we respond. Rarely does someone take the time to think it through, because it's something which requires from us a level of patience and calmness. Allah Azza wa Jalla establishes this principle in multiple ways in the Quran. In the way that the Quran was revealed to our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma says that at the beginning of revelation, when Jibreel alayhi salam would come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with verses of the Quran, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would repeat hastily after him, out of fear that he would forget those verses, because of the responsibility that was being placed upon his shoulders sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah Azza wa Jalla said to him in Surah Al-Qiyamah, لَا تُحَرِّكْ بِهِ لِسَانَكَ لِتَعْجَلَ بِهِ. Don't hasten the movement of your tongue to rush with the Quran, because he would read so quickly out of fear of forgetting the book of Allah Azza wa Jalla, the verses of the Quran. Allah Azza wa Jalla said to him, read calmly. وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا. Read in a calm and collected manner. That was the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is why it became then an established principle in seeking knowledge, that the student of knowledge has to be a person that is calm, a person that is patient, a person that looks at the long game as opposed to the short gains. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this principle in the stories of the prophets. From the characteristics of the prophets alayhi wa salatu wa salam is that they were people who were calm, people who were collected, people who didn't rush and weren't hasty to make decisions. Allah Azza wa Jalla mentions in the story of the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, how often did Allah give him a command and he hastened to fulfill that command, but not in such a way that he didn't think it through. He was patient with what Allah Azza wa Jalla commanded him to be. So when Allah said to him, leave your son Ismail and his mother Hajar in the valley of Mecca, he did so. And when Allah said, go and slaughter your son Ismail, he agreed to do so. And when Allah commanded him to raise the foundations of the Kaaba, he immediately went and did so. Allah Azza wa Jalla says concerning Ibrahim, إِنَّ إِبْرَاهِيمَ لَحَلِيمٌ أَوَّاهٌ مُنِيبٌ. From the characteristics of the Prophet Ibrahim is that he was a man of patience. Because patience sometimes means taking the ability, or having the ability to withstand the pressures that are around you. Someone says something, someone does something, you have to be able to deal with those types of issues and not just lash out, not just be reactionary every time someone says or does something around you, or the wider issues that you face in the community, in the ummah, to deal with them with a level of wisdom and calmness and a level of reason. It's from the principles of the sharia. Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us in the story of the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, when he was unjustly entered into prison, 10 years or so he remained there, unjust, oppressed, didn't deserve to be in prison, but because of the circumstances that he was in. But Allah Azza wa Jalla also tells us that when the king had his dream interpreted by the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, he sent someone, one of his people, and he said, tell this man to come out of prison, I know that he's innocent. But when he came and he gave him that option, come, O Yusuf, leave prison, he said no. Not until he asks those women to declare my innocence, the same women who, as a result of their testimony, I was put into prison in the first place. The Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith, commenting on this verse, لَوْ لَبِثْتُ فِي السِّجْنِ مَا لَبِثَ يُوسُفُ لَأَجَبْتُ الدَّاعِي. Had I remained in prison for as long as Yusuf had, and then that man came to me and said that I could leave, I would have just responded. I wouldn't have told him to go back, ask, find my innocence, declare it. And that is from the virtues of this Prophet Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. And so it became a principle of our religion. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam instilled this within his companions. Allah Azza wa Jalla in Surah Al-Ahzab, He mentions addressing the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because some of them had started to complain about their life. Well, not complain, but they had hardships that they had to deal with, and it's natural. If you live in a family or you have a husband and a wife and your means are restricted, your times are difficult, that you're going to raise those issues with your husband, with your family. The wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some of them said, O Messenger of Allah, our situation is hard. We don't have enough money. 2 months would go past or three, and they wouldn't light a fire in his house, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They would survive on dates and on water. Sometimes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have nothing to eat or break his, have his breakfast with, so he would fast that day. So some of them mentioned this to him. Allah Azza wa Jalla in Surah Al-Ahzab gave those wives a choice. Allah said, either you can be from the people of the Akhirah, the people that want to be with Allah and His Messenger, and therefore you have to be patient. That's the trade-off. Or you can have the dunya, take the wealth of the dunya, have the blessings of the dunya, but if that's your choice, then separate from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When those verses were revealed, Aisha radiallahu anha says that I was the first of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he came to. And he said, Oh Aisha, I'm going to give you a choice between two things. Allah has said this in the Quran. Allah has given you this choice. I will present this choice to you. But don't be hasty in making your decision until you seek advice from your parents. So then he mentioned and recited to her these two verses. And she said, O Messenger of Allah, do you think that I ever need to seek advice in something like this? I choose Allah, His Messenger, and Ad-Darul Akhirah, the afterlife. But look at how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying to her, don't be hasty, don't be rash. Some decisions you need to take your time, and that should be the default of the Muslim. And that is why when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the 8th year of the Hijrah was planning to go and conquer the city of Mecca, and the companion Hatib ibn Abi Balta'ah radiallahu anhu wrote that letter disclosing the secrets of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the people of Mecca. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam extracted that letter, had it brought back. And when he read it and saw what was in it, he didn't rush, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wasn't hasty in the way that he behaved. He called Hatib and he said, why did you do this? So Hatib told him, O Messenger of Allah, these other companions of Mecca, they have people in Mecca that will look after their interests and their affairs. I have no one there. So I wanted to just get some favor from some of the people of Mecca that they would look after my interests. And I knew that it wouldn't make a difference. Allah would decree what He would decree. And I never did what I did out of hatred for Islam or for the Muslims. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam accepted his excuse. Let him go. Even though what he did on the face of it was a major sin. Something which is grave and serious. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't one to rush in his affairs. Wasn't one to rush in the decisions that he made sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is an important principle in the times that we live in. Because each and every day we're faced with so many different things. Sometimes we don't even know if they're true or correct. And Allah Azza wa Jal tells us part of this principle. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِن جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَئٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا. If you have news that reaches you, the first thing that you should do is verify. You can only verify if you're going to be calm, you're going to be patient, you're going to take the time and make the effort to go and see whether that is actually true or not. Perhaps he had an excuse. Perhaps there's a different version of events. Perhaps there was a misunderstanding somewhere. But all of those maybes and all of those possibilities can only be seen and pursued if someone is calm. And that is why Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala, said that it used to be said, At-ta'anni min Allah wal-ajalatu min ash-shaytan. Calmness is from Allah and hastiness is from shaytan. And there is a hadith to that effect, but the scholars differed over its authenticity. Calmness is from Allah, but hastiness is what shaytan wants, because when you're hasty, sometimes that leads you to committing major sins and oppression against others. To be calm, that is something beloved to Allah, as the Prophet said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to that man from the tribe of Abdul Qais. Ask Allah Azza wa Jal that He gives us patience, that He makes us from those people who are calm, and that He gives us guidance of the Quran and the Sunnah in doing so. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Quran wa Sunnah. Wa nafa'ani wa yakum bima fihima min al-ayati wal hikmah. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa li jami'i al-muslimin min kulli dhanbin fastaghfiruhu innahu kana ghaffara. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه وسلم تسليما كثيرا أما بعد. Alongside this principle of being calm and being patient, we have another principle in our religion. And the beauty of our religion is that it gives everything its due right. There is a time and place for everything. So just as the default and the norm is that you should be calm and patient, there's also a time to be hasty, a time to rush, a time to be quick and fast. Allah Azza wa Jalla tells us in the Quran, فَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ. Be hasty when it comes to attaining good deeds. And Allah Azza wa Jalla describes His prophets in the Quran, and then He says concerning them, إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ. They would hurry and rush towards good deeds. And Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ. Compete with one another, race towards Allah's forgiveness and towards Jannah. But at the same time, even though that should be your demeanor when it comes to rushing towards that which is good, as the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in the hadith of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas radiyallahu anhu, what is collected in the Sunan of Abi Dawood, at-tu'adatu fi kulli shay illa fi amal al-akhirah. Calmness is in every affair except in the affairs of the hereafter. We should be hurrying and rushing towards the goodness of Allah Azza wa Jalla and His reward. But even as you rush towards that, the Sharia also says that that shouldn't compromise the quality of the good deeds that you do. You should rush towards coming to the salah, rush towards fasting, rush towards all of the good deeds. But once you start that process, there should be calmness upon you. The Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, about the person who's walking to the masjid, you should rush towards the salah, towards the masjid. But he said, as you walk, walk wa alaykum as-sakinata wal waqar. Walk and you walk with tranquility and ease. Meaning don't rush towards the prayer, rush towards the concept, rush towards the opportunity, rush towards taking the reward. But that shouldn't compromise the quality that you rush so much that you don't even pray properly or correctly, or that you're not fulfilling the conditions and the obligations of the ibadah and that act of worship. That's the beauty of our religion, has balance. Beauty of our religion is that everything has its time and place. And with this correct understanding, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens up for you many doors of goodness, many doors of blessings. Allahumma arina al-haqqa haqqan warzuqna ittiba'a. Wa arina al-batila batilan warzuqna ijtinaba. Allahumma wa la taj'alhu multabisan alayna fanadil. Allahumma inna nas'aluka al-huda wal-tuqa wal-afafa wal-ghina. Allahumma ati nufusana taqwaha. وزكيها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات. اللهم فرج هم المهمومين ونفس كرب المكروبين واقض الدين عن المدينين واشف مرضانا ومرضى المسلمين وارحم موتانا وموتى المسلمين. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.